To identify genetic factors that may be involved in a particular trait, we conduct something called a genetic association study. Now, these studies take people with a trait, for example, a skin condition, and really they take a whole population of people with this trait, and they compare their genetics to an individual or really a group of individuals without this particular trait, in this case, without the skin condition. Now, what we're going to do is look at a genetic factor or more, and we're going to see which variants each population has. Now, if a certain genetic variant is observed more frequently than you would expect by chance in the actual cases than the controls, then it's good evidence that it might be involved in the trait. Suppose that we have 1,000 people that have a particular kind of skin rash, and we compare them to 1,000 people that don't have this particular kind of skin rash. Now, let's say we analyze these two populations for one particular genetic factor. And let's say we determine that 50% of the population with the skin rash has a cytosine for this genetic factor at a given position, and that in the control population, only 20% have a cytosine. Now, at that same position, the only other option that we can have is an adenine. In our affected population, the other 50%, the remaining 50% have an adenine. And in our control population, the remaining, in this case, 80% have the adenine. Now, we have a lot of people in our population, 1,000. If this letter was insignificant to this particular trait, we would expect that with so many people, that these numbers would be more similar, 50-50, 50-50, or 20-80, 20-80 in both situations. In other words, these differences are greater than what we would expect to see by chance. So based on the scenario here, I want you to tell me which of the following is the most reasonable conclusion.